joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. For the Lord is good and his mercy everlasting. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dearly beloved, I greet each one of you in the name of the triune faithful God. Even as we unite our hearts together to worship him, let us lift up our voice to sing the opening hymn, hymn number 48, Praise to the Lord the Almighty. Glory be to you, O Lord Most High. Blessed is the one who has come and is to come in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, O God. Holy are you, O God. Holy are you, O Almighty. Holy are you, O Almighty. Holy are you, O Immortal. Holy are you, O Immortal. O Lord, our Redeemer, who was crucified for us, have mercy on us. O Lord, our Redeemer, who was crucified for us, have mercy on us. O Lord, the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. O Lord, the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. O Lord, accept our prayers and praises and have mercy upon us. O Lord, have compassion and have mercy upon us. Confession. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I will get up and go to my Father and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but have one who is in every respect have been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us kneel and examine ourselves in silence. Let us unite together and say the prayer of confession. Almighty and most merciful God, we have erred and strayed from our ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we should have done, and we have done those things which we should not have done. And there is no truth in us. But you, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare them, O God, who confess their faults. Restore them that are bent according to your promises declared to humankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful God, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and just life, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. May the Almighty and Merciful Lord grant us pardon and remission of all our sins, time for amendment of life, and the grace and comfort of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise the Lord. The Lord's name be praised. Let us unite together in the litany of dedication and thanksgiving for stewardship. God be with you and also with you. Let us pray. Creator God, giver of life, we thank you for the gift of life and the goodness of creation that sustains and delights us. With the greatness of heart, we dedicate these to you. Great Redeemer, generous and sovereign, we thank you for the gift of salvation and the healing that forgives and frees us. With grateful hearts, we offer our lives to you. Font of every blessing, thank you for every gift that unites and inspires the Church to share the abundance of your grace to the world. We sing our praise and shout for joy. Hallelujah. Amen. We will now be favored by a special number from our youth department.
Every single lie that tells me
will now have the scripture readings read to us, the Old Testament epistle and the gospel lesson.
The Old Testament lesson is taken from the book of Exodus, chapter 18, verses 13 to 27. Exodus chapter 18, beginning at verse 13. The next day Moses took his seat to serve as judge for the people, and they stood around him from morning till evening. When his father-in-law saw all that Moses was doing for the people, he said, "What is this you are doing for the people? Why do you alone sit as judge, while all these people stand around you from morning till evening?" Moses answered him, "Because the people come to me to seek God's will. Whenever they have a dispute, it is brought to me, and I decide between the parties and inform them God's decree and instructions." Moses' father-in-law replied, "What you are doing is not good. You and these people who come to you will only wear yourselves out. The work is too heavy for you. You cannot handle it alone. Listen now to me, and I will give you some advice. And may God be with you. You must be the people's representative before God and bring their disputes to him. Teach them his decrees and instructions, and show them the way they are to live and how they are to behave. But select capable men from all the people, men who fear God, trustworthy men who hate dishonest gain, and appoint them as officials over thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens. Have them serve as judges for the people at all times, but have them bring every difficult case to you. The simple cases they can decide themselves. That will make your load lighter, because they will share it with you. If you do this, and God so commands, you will be able to stand the strain, and all these people will go home satisfied." Moses listened to his father-in-law and did everything he said. He chose capable men from all Israel and made them leaders of the people, officials over thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens. They served as judges for the people at all times. The difficult cases they brought to Moses, but the simple ones they decided themselves. Then Moses sent his father-in-law on his way, and Jethro returned to his own country. Here ends the reading. Thanks be to thee, O God.
The epistle lesson is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verses 1 to 15. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verses 1 to 15. Christian giving. Our brothers, we want you to know what God's grace has accomplished in the churches in Macedonia. They have been severely tested by the troubles they went through, but their joy was so great that they were extremely generous in their giving, even though they are very poor. I can assure you that they gave as much as they could, and even more than they could. Of their own free will, they begged us and pleaded for the privilege of having a part in helping God's people in Judea. It was more than we could have hoped for. First, they gave themselves to the Lord, and then, by God's will, they gave themselves to us as well. So we urged Titus, who began this work, to continue it and help you complete the special service of love. You are so rich in all you have, in faith, speech, and knowledge, in your eagerness to help, and in your love for us. And so we want you to be generous also in this service of love. I am not laying down any rules, but by showing how eager others are to help, I am trying to find out how real your own love is. You know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Rich as he was, he made himself poor for your sake, in order to make you rich by means of his poverty. My opinion is that it is better for you to finish now what you began last year. You were the first not only to act, but also to be willing to act. On with it then, and finish the job. Be as eager to finish it as you were to plan it, and do it with what you now have. If you are eager to give, God will accept your gift on the basis of what you have to give. not on what you haven't. I am not trying to relieve others by putting a burden on you, but since you have plenty at this time, it is only fair that you should help those who are in need. Then, when you are in need and they have plenty, they will help you. In this way, both are treated equally. As the scripture says, the one who gathered much did not have too much, and the one who gathered little did not have too little. May God add his blessings to the reading of his word.
Gospel reading is taken from Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 25, verses 14 to 13. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents of money, to another 2 talents, to another 1 talent, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received the 5 talents went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 more. So also one with the 2 talents gained 2 more. But the man who had received 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 talents brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrust me with the 5 talents, see, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The man with the 2 talents also came. Master, you said, you entrusted with me 2 talents. See, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the man who received the 1 talent came. Master, he said, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your talent in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant, so you knew what I harvest, where I have not sown and gathered I have not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers, so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. Take the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10 talents. For everyone who has will be given more, and he will be have abundance. Whoever does not have even what he has will be taken from him. And throw what worthless servant outside into darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Here ends the gospel reading. Close to God. Amen.
Dearly beloved, let me take this opportunity to introduce the preacher for today. It is Reverend Dennis. He is presently teaching as an assistant professor at Corinth Theological Seminary. And he is my husband. I am happy to introduce you all to the congregation. And he will be sharing the word of God with us this morning after we join to sing the hymn number 205. Take my life and let it be.
Take my life. Dear people of God, I deem it as a privilege and honor to bring God's word to you this morning. Shall we look to God in prayer? Redeeming, restoring, sustaining God, God who takes pleasure in those who honor you, God who gives his message to his people, speak to us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Dearly beloved, the theme given for our reflection this morning is Stewardship, Responsible Resource Management. Stewardship, Responsible Resource Management. At what age does stewardship start? Let me begin with a small anecdote. As the offering plates were being passed during worship, a little boy seated with his father whispered loudly, "Don't pay for me, Daddy. I am under five. Don't pay for me, Daddy. I am under five." One of the most incisive, instructive, engaging, and humbling images of the Christian is that of a steward. The New Testament definition of the word steward is with reference to someone who oversees, administers, manages under a commissioning trust that authorizes them to do so. The most common New Testament Greek term for steward is the Greek word oikonomos. Managing family is the Greek word oikia. Managing household is the word oikos. The steward held a trusted appointment to manage something in the interest of the one who owned it. The Apostle Peter extended the application of the stewardship image to inform all believers that they are entrusted persons. In the epistle of 1 Peter chapter 4 verse 10, Apostle Peter says, "Like good stewards of the manifold grace of God, serve one another with whatever gift each of you have received." To put in a simple manner, stewardship is using God-given abilities to manage God-owned assets to accomplish God-ordained results. May I repeat? Stewardship is using God-given abilities to manage God-owned assets to accomplish God-ordained results. The Bible lessons have been read to us, and from these three Bible lessons, I would like to present before us three models of stewardship. Firstly, the Jethro Moses model, which we find in the book of Exodus, chapter 18, verses 13 to 27. In-laws are a favorite butt of jokes. Rarely are they portrayed in a positive light. But God places us in extended families to give us added wisdom and to shave off our rough edges. Jethro comes to Moses, bringing his wife and children back to him, and he also brings praise and worship to God. But he doesn't stop there. He, that is Jethro, made Moses face up to a weak link in his command. Jethro could be accused of meddling, but he was God's deliverer for Moses and Israel, just as Joshua and his soldiers were. And the Jethro Moses model gives us insights as to how we need to do the responsible resource management. Jethro's counsel to Moses, or his advice to Moses, was to enlist helpers to carry the load. Firstly, we find here in this passage Jethro finds Moses in a situation where from morning till night, Moses is listening to the pleas of the people of God, and there are people waiting to see him and bring their concerns to him. Probably some of them have waited too long through the day but didn't get the opportunity to meet him. They return back, and Moses too returns to home tired. Looking at this situation of a kind of burnout, being stressed out under this heavy load of doing every work all alone, Jethro gives Moses a clear counsel and advice. We read in chapter 18 of Exodus, in verse 19, Jethro encourages Moses, yes, you continue to pray for them. You continue to bring their cases before God. It is good. And then, as you continue to intercede for them, he teaches Moses also to teach them the guidelines. That is, to teach them the policies, the procedures, the rules, and the laws as he has received from God. So basically, we see here in this model, Jethro teaches Moses the important principle of dependence, and he also tells them to show them the way and also show them the work which they have to engage themselves in. Biblical faith is not simply a recital of odd isolated events of rescue. It is also about the hard, sustained work of nurturing and practicing the daily passion of healing and restoring, and the daily rejection of dishonest gain. As the people of God are still in their wilderness journey, Moses is told to be an agent of bringing healing and restoration to people by depending upon God and upon people. Not only that, we also find here in this model an important aspect of delegation. Organize the people into manageable groups. We read that in verse 21. Moses was to organize the people into manageable groups. The pattern was to have groups of thousands, which in turn would have groups of hundreds. The hundreds groups were further subdivided into 50s, and 50s into groups of 10. This was the organization design. And then Jethro tells him to choose qualified persons to lead each group. We read in verse 21a, what are the qualities that these people should have? They should be able, God-fearing, truthful, and haters of unjust gain. And their span of leadership was reasonable. And then they were given the span of leadership so that they can effectively do justice to the assignment given unto them. Choose qualified persons. And then Jethro tells him, give the chosen leaders continuing authority so that they will be able to fulfill their responsibilities, and have leaders decide the routine matters and only bring great matters to the chief leader, Moses. Hence Moses appoints judges who were to bring only the matters which they couldn't resolve to Moses. He was to manage by exception. Dearly beloved, at this juncture in the life of the people of God, Moses learns the important lesson of teamwork, of dependence and delegation. Somebody said it beautifully, Teamworks makes the dream work. Teamwork makes the dream work. Secondly, we move on from the Jethro model, Moses model, to the Pauline model of responsible resource management. We read here an account of the generosity of the Macedonian church and its believers. And Apostle Paul very plainly presents this as an account of the work of the grace of God in their church. The Macedonians are said to have given voluntarily in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 3. Paul says that in the midst of severe ordeal of affliction and the extreme poverty out of which the Macedonians have given their share of the collection, we find here the paradox of abundant joy in extreme poverty. They were impoverished on the one hand, but in the midst of their impoverishment, they could be a blessing to the church which was in need at Jerusalem. Dearly beloved, every spending decision is a spiritual decision. Your checkbook is a theological document. Your audit statements, income tax returns, are theological documents. They gave in their poverty generously. Secondly, we find the collection for the Jerusalem church is said to be a ministry. In chapter 8, verse 4, Apostle Paul has used the word repeatedly in defense of his work among the Gentiles. Now the same word is applied to the collection of money from the Corinthians for the saints. A ministry that fails to bring life and well-being to others is unworthy of Christian confession. Stewardship is discipleship. Stewardship does not equate with giving. However, a good steward will also be a good giver. But a good giver is not necessarily a good steward. Thirdly, we find the ministry is for the saints. The ministry of giving is for the saints. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 4b. Who are these people so designated to whom this gift is being sent? When we read the context, Apostle Paul is referring to the church at Jerusalem, and the people there are those who are the poor, which is also mentioned in Galatians chapter 2 verse 10. The ministry is for the saints. Christians is a general term, but the Greek word saints can refer to people in a community of faith in Christ. People who are in a community of faith in Christ. Fourthly, the Macedonians receive praise as a model in giving themselves first to the Lord and by the will of God to the apostles. The apostles, as a result of their ministry, we find that the people of God gave themselves to God first and also committed themselves to the ministry of the apostles in their team. The terminology to give oneself connotes sacrifice or a form of reverent devotion. They gave themselves to the Lord, the apostle says. They gave themselves to the Lord and to us, stand together under the single verb, they gave. This shows us that the Macedonians gave themselves to the Lord and they simultaneously gave themselves to the Apostle Paul. The significance of first to the Lord is not sequence but priority. First and foremost, they gave themselves to the Lord and to us, and that by the will of God. Having given themselves to the Lord and to his minister, the gift of money, for the saints flowed joyfully from their hearts and hands. Martin Luther said it very beautifully, there must be the conversion of the heart, the mind, and the purse. There must be the conversion of the heart, the mind, and also the purse. Thirdly, we come to the Jesus' model of responsible resource management. I'll be very brief here. Jesus engaged in equipping ministry throughout his public ministry with his disciples. And Jesus continued to empower the disciples in their particular gifts that they had. And in Matthew chapter 25 verses 14 to 30, we have this story where the owner gives the slaves different talents, big amounts of money. And then he goes for a long journey. Matthew Gospel presents the Christian life as waiting for parousia, that is the return of Christ. And we know what happens, how the first and the second slaves were able to multiply and double their talents. And they get this reward or the acknowledgement by their master, "You good and faithful servant, you are good and faithful servant, you were honest and you were fruitful with the things which were assigned to you." What does it mean to be good and faithful? Good and faithful is not mere theological correctness. It is not passive waiting or strict obedience to clear instructions, but active responsibility that takes initiative and risk. In the story, the master gives no instruction as to what is to be done with the money. So faithfulness is not merely obedience to directions. Each servant must decide how to use his time during the master's absence. We have sung that beautiful hymn, "Take My Life and Let It Be," written by Francis R. Avergal in the year 1874. Meditating on this verse from 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 31, "So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God." The gold that came from thee, Lord, to thee belongeth still. O may I always faithfully my stewardship fulfill. It was said of Francis Ripley Avergal, the author of this hymn, that the beauty of a consecrated life was never more perfectly revealed than in her daily living. She was rightfully called the consecration poet. "These little couplets that chime in my heart one after another," she writes, "were bubbling from my heart." She would say, "Take my voice and let me sing only for my King." It was personally significant for Frances because she was naturally very musical and had been trained as a concert soloist with an unusually pleasant voice. Her musical talents could have brought her much worldly fame. However, she determined that her life's mission was to sing and work only for Jesus. The lines, "Take my silver and my gold," was also sincerely phrased. At one time, Frances gathered together her many fine pieces of jewelry and other family heirlooms and shipped them to the church missionary house to be used for evangelism. Nearly 50 articles were sent with extreme delight. Hence she could write those beautiful lines, "Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Take my voice and let me sing always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages for thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my love, my God, I pour at thy feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee, ever only all for thee." Dearly beloved, shall we express once more our gratitude for all God's gifts? Shall we dedicate ourselves more completely to His glory and service? Sing these words of consecration in our hearts as we pause for a moment of silent reflection. Loving God, You are ever active in this world, and You have asked us to be Your stewards. Forgive us for the times we have let You down and have used our gifts and talents for our self-glory, for our unjust gain. Continue to inspire us that we use our talents, our abilities, only for fulfilling God-ordained results and purposes through which Your kingdom would be established. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Having been exhorted by God's word, may we all affirm our faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us join in the litany of stewardship. Let us pray for the wisdom and courage to make stewardship a way of life with God. We acknowledge You are the source of all that we have and all that we are. Help us to place You first in our lives by being more prayerful and focused on loving our families, caring for those in need, by becoming less preoccupied with material things. Help us to find the true source of happiness and fulfillment that You alone can bring. Help us to hear Your call to be good stewards of all Your gifts by sharing them for Your very purposes. Help us to challenge each other as disciples of Jesus Christ to put our faith into action. Lord, help us how to give back the talents that we have been blessed, how to share our treasure to do Your work, to serve our church, our community, and our world with Your gifts. Help us to put our trust and faith in You. We pray we have a joyful spirit of mind and of heart. Amen.
Countenance upon you and give you gracious unto you, then be gracious. The Lord be gracious, gracious unto you. Amen.
Let's go to God in prayer. Almighty God, our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for giving us this privilege to be found in your presence. Lord, you have called us to be your stewards. You have called us to be people who are accountable to you, people who are willing to fulfill your purposes here on earth. We thank you for encouraging us. Lord God, at this time we especially want to thank you for our Wesleyan family. Thank you for the way you have kept all of us under your mighty wings, protecting us from every harm and danger, especially during these days where there is so much of evil, so much of pain and suffering in this world because of the pandemic. But you continue to protect us and preserve us. We just want to thank you, Lord. We also want to pray for our parish members and their families, that in your mercy you will continue to enable us to experience your healing and your sustaining grace in our lives. We want to thank you for those celebrating their birthdays and anniversaries. May these dear ones continue to experience your nearness and your strength in their life's journey. May they continue to be your mighty witnesses throughout this year as you empower them. Lord, we also want to pray for our country as we go through this pandemic. We need your wisdom, we need your healing, dear Lord. We confess our helplessness and we totally rely upon you. And we pray that you would deliver us from this pandemic globally. Once again, we want to thank you and praise you, Lord, for hearing and answering our prayers. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
With confidence in our hearts, let us receive the benediction. May the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, love of God our Heavenly Father, the sweet communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit, rest with you, abide with you, now and forevermore. Amen. Number 203, just as I am. Let us join in singing the closing hymn, hymn number 203, just as I am.